Lisa is the associate professor in the Department of Cultural Study in Lingnan University. He teaches and researches historical cultural studies of colonialism, comparative social thought, and Hong Kong and cultural formation. He has authored a number of books, including The Collaborative Colonial Power, The Making of the Hong Kong Chinese, and has been very active in commenting on public affairs of Hong Kong in the mass media. Without further ado, may I call on Wing Sang to give his talk. Thanks.
Thanks so much for Wing Sang's very nice introduction. I've been delighted to be invited to speak at this conference, especially for geographer. I must confess that I am not a geographer. I was a geographer before, but later it turned to something else. I'm more interested in cultural study and using the historical approach and focus on Hong Kong. Speaking at a conference organized by the Department of Geography of the Baptist College has a special meaning for me because it reminds me of the beginning of my own academic career. Because my first job to teach in Hong Kong was actually on two courses within a semester dating back to 1989. I taught political geography to the Baptist student as a short-term employed lecturer. It was also the moment when radicalism carried special meaning because I remember vividly that during the class of my political geography, that was also the period when the 1989 democratic movement in Beijing happened. And I remember after I finished my class, I immediately joined with a group of friends, including Lo Becker, who are also coming to this conference, and also Poon Ngai and Jack Chiu, also a former colleague in the sociology department of the Baptist University. We went together to Beijing and joined the student movement then, and that was my radicalism, radical past. I've been assigned the task to speak not as a specialist or expert in spatial matter, because I'm not. I start being interested in urban issue when I was attempting to do a PhD in success. University with Andrew Sayer and Peter Saunders as my supervisor. But after the the June 4 event, I gave up the PhD study and turned my interest to more a temporal matter. So if one would say, this century you'll have to take a spatial turn for social theory, then I have to confess that I return back to time. I'm more interested in history. So I'm assigned the task today to speak about the history of Hong Kong, putting our discussion in a very concrete context and how to understand Hong Kong and how radicalism of different kinds develop and what problem we are facing. So the first, I think to understand Hong Kong, we have to focus on two concepts. First, of course, is colonial city. Hong Kong is a colonial city. It was ceded to the Britain since 1842. It functioned as a free trade port. It drawing upon Wallerstein theory, it occupies semi-periphery in his world system analysis. But from what my limited knowledge of the study of city, not many has been done enough on the colonial city. If I'm wrong, please correct me. I think the key to understand Hong Kong as a colonial city has to take into account that the imperial project of Britain. It applied indirect rule, that means Chinese elite and merchant were co-opted, and also no imposition of British culture upon Hong Kong citizen. That means Hong Kong citizen can remain and retain their own Chinese identity throughout. the most significant anti-British struggle happened in 1920s, mid-1920s. It happened in the Canton-Hong Kong general strike. But this entire imperial struggle did not bring down the British colonial rule. And also, as time went on, when the anti-Japanese war broke out in the mid-1930s, Britain allowed anti-Japanese activity in Hong Kong. So after then, Britain was no longer the target of any anti-imperialism. Hong Kong should also be understood as basically an immigrant city, or you may say refugee cities. That means it was populated by constant inflow and outflow of immigrants, sojourner, or refugee, from Taiping Rebellion, anti-Japanese war, down to the Great Leap Forward. You know, throughout all this period, a lot of people coming in and out of Hong Kong. There was no strict border control between mainland China and Hong Kong before the Japanese occupation, and no clear, distinct local and original population, except what you find in new territories in the much later date, 1898. That also the cause of the so-called 1997 issue. the indication of that is the there was only a nebulous concept of local identity and no concept of citizenship were there. And secondly, Hong Kong is a city of refuge. That means people coming to Hong Kong willingly. It posed a quite significant theoretical question for how colonial modernity means to the local so-called colonized people. That I think we may easily find that within a city occupying that semi-political status. You see people were willingly coming to be colonized. So it poses a contradiction within what Hong Kong is about. You see a refugee. But a third angle to understand Hong Kong is the Cold War. Party rivalry between KMT and the CCP, KMT, the Kuomintang, the Nationalist Party, and CCP, the Communist Party, ran through the year before and after the war. Their confrontation, their rivalry, allowed the British colonial government in Hong Kong to gain legitimacy by maintaining a sense of political neutrality. British Hong Kong government adopted policy throughout, the policy of depoliticization, meaning it cracked down heavily on any political motivated disturbances. It kept a heavy surveillance on political groups. It meant it would impose strict censorship on visual media, but at the same time, it maintained, by and large, free press, except under extreme emergency time. It also means that the British Hong Kong government would like to have apolitical and ahistorical education to the Hong Kong people. Apart from all these measures, you may say both the left and the right were for most of the time free to compete in gaining support. And the only radicalism you find today in those times is in that time is the labor movement. But under the Cold War condition, labor movement was stagnant because of the political factionalism, and trade union membership remained low. to understand the very special colonial status of Hong Kong, especially after the war, supposedly PLC has all the power to take back Hong Kong, you have to take into account the policy of so-called long-term planning and full utilization. That means in CCP's eye, they recognize Hong Kong has special status, and that special status was beneficial to CCP too. For example, in Korean War, Hong Kong served the place where PRC would break the UN embargo from Hong Kong. They can get strategic goods, foreign exchanges, and they could also use Hong Kong as a place for intelligence collecting, information collecting, place where unification activity could be freely held. So in a sense, the continuation of British rule in Hong Kong was actually endorsed by the CCP. That is why, through my looking back, reviewing the past colonial history of Hong Kong, I propose you a concept called collaborative colonialism in Hong Kong. That means the colonialism, not the usual way we understand about the opposition between colonizer and colonized. That means the colonized also contribute a large part to the formation of the power formation. Apart from CCP, the KMP also wanted to see Hong Kong being kept under British rule. But the colonial status of Hong Kong, for the very specific reason I just explained, were persistently denied by the CCP. What I want to focus on is to see the implication for the development of radicalism. Under the long-term planning of full utilization policy, Latin Circle activity was actually restrained by the PPC itself. That means no activity would be allowed to destabilize British rule in Hong Kong. So I would try to capture this situation by the term of compromised left radicalism. That means for the leftists, for China leftists in Hong Kong, their main task is to promote patriotism rather than teaching people radical ideas. Because gaining loyalty to the PRC regime ranked much higher in priority than radicalism. So their main duty in Hong Kong is to launch propaganda war. Of course, the achievement of the new China has to be publicized. Criticism against colonialism and imperialism, of course, would be their main ideology. But it would be reserved for those who have higher political consciousness. For a little field. So the result is socialism, communism was praised but would not put in practice in Hong Kong. The left trade union were mostly grassroots service unit providing cheap Chinese product to build communal support for workers' solidarities. But all these balance was broken in the 1967 riot. Hong Kong expressed the rapid economic growth in 1960, yet the industrial conflict was also intensified for lack of labor legislation. In 1967, the pro-PRC leftists were inspired by the Cultural Revolution in mainland China. They tried to imitate what they have done in Macau successfully and to really marginalize the Portuguese government. But in Hong Kong, they tried, but without success. During the riot, it was caused by an industrial dispute for pay, but it very quickly turned into a much bigger scale riot all over Hong Kong, enough to terrorist attack, arson, murder, bombing, etc. Hong Kong government cracked down on the riots in the same way they cracked down on the right-wing incited double super ten. So-called Double Ten riot 11 years ago. The result of the indication of this riot is immense because the leftist violence alienated the general public. The Hong Kong colonial government earned support from the populace. This event was very significant in Hong Kong because in reaction to this huge-scale disturbance, Governor McNeil launched a series of social reform which earned for the late colonial government wide support and legitimacy. So yeah, feel short about these 67 riot. A lot of Maoists, Chinese Maoists, went to the street and clashed with the policemen forcefully, causing a lot of casualty. Even the secondary school student joined the struggle, kicked out the British colonialists, and so on and so forth. But in that, there's this murder, bloody murder. But this murder has never been resolved, so it caused a kind of so-called within the Hong Kong's a kind of trauma that has not sit for full reconciliation up to now. What I'm focusing on is not looking back into this old form of radicalism, but to from then on to talk about new radicalism after the 67 riots. 67 was widely perceived as a watershed in Hong Kong, although the pro-China leftists failed in the 1967 riot, it nevertheless stimulated youngsters to undergo a political awakening process. They were the first post-World War II local-born generation, we call them baby boomers. Through the riot, they became sensitive to local social problems, they wanted political participation, breaking away from the old political apathy under the Cold War confrontation. They had much stronger anti-colonial sentiment than their earlier generation. They were puzzled by the issue of Hong Kong's future, just like recently many Hong Kong youngsters were also puzzled by the Hong Kong future, but it's just a kind of repetition of what happened 50 years ago. They were bored by the stalemate caused by the Cold War rivalry between the two local parties, and they want to draw upon new sources to inspire their radical inclination. It developed then not on the confrontation on the streets that much, but it turned to a kind of campus-based social activism. This youth activism, you may consider that as them as a belated impact of the worldwide youth counterculture and new lab activism. A new source of radical thought and practice other than that offered by PMT or CCP, immensely welcomed by the university or college student. Throughout this, the campaign, the local campaign that I this year, the campaign for Chinese or official language, defending Stereo Thai Island movement, the anti-corruption movement over the corporate issue, campaign to reopen the Golden Jubilee School campaign, the campaign for both Darrell Wright. This all captured the mood and sentiment for radicalism after the 67 riot. And that period, the whole 70s period, was a moment when Hong Kong's civil society emerged. You can get some idea about all these very peaceful demonstrations, only slightly clashes with the policemen would be seen. You see, they went out to speak for the issue about the interests of Chinese nation, the territorial issue, which supposedly was beyond Hong Kong's political reach. No one can would think that Hong Kong government can play any part in this controversy, but the young people then take this Chinese nationalism issue as their own issue, and because the CCP PR, mainland China was silent on that issue, and both the KMT was too weak to face up to the American government, they consider themselves playing a very important part to voice out this Chinese nationalism. Okay, you see the mix of ideology here. Here, the background of these students having protests is the Queen's Pier, we will soon talk about. But you see the protests in front of them, raising protests, putting placards, having Dr. Sun Yat-sen's photo. You see both the student with the left-wing inclination and right-wing inclination joined together and waging this Chinese nationalist cause. But over the year, we in Hong Kong, most social historians will characterize that era as so-called the red era, because In the Cold War, you see, by and large, the right-wing kind of ideology held dominancy among the university student, the youngster, but in the 70s, the left-wing turned towards, but not to follow exactly the CCP pro-China's ideology, but new kind of radical thought was more attractive, like New Marxism, Trotskyism, and anarchism. Of course, there were also a group of very pro-China Maoists also joining the student movement then. They took the left turn vis-a-vis the old Confucian cultural conservatism, the right-wing Chinese nationalism dominated the Cold War era. In between the two ends were the idea of liberal democracy and also reformism. The dominant faction among the college students was the pro-China Maoists. We call them Guochuipai in Putonghua. After the end of the Cultural Revolution, this group Maoists collapsed, and some remained silent and politically inactive, but some of them have turned into the pro-China establishment elements now. The wider faction then was the societal reformists. It is a very loose faction, loosely categorized faction. Almost all the non-Maoists, the students who held a certain critical stand against the line blindly followed by the Maoists who just followed what the CCP instructed them to do, were considered as these societal reformers. Later, they become the leading activists in the housing movement or other political field, and most of them became the founding member of the different political parties in the 1980s. All this radical era, called the Red Era, after no more than 10 years, or slightly more than 10 years development, they face a new challenge. This new challenge is the democratization of Hong Kong. Let's first see some of the propagation of those highly politically motivated radical reading or trying to produce. This Peng Wu was a Maoist, and the 70s belonged to the Trotskyists and anarchists, some of the anarchists. All these radical ideas have been absorbed by these radical students, and even very cultural avant-garde, represented by these Menfa Sanqiu. The rise of civil society. You know, throughout the 70s, we saw in Hong Kong two main social movements. First is the independent labor movement, second is the housing movement. These emergency of the independent labor movement were largely locally oriented. They have organized in trade union, different industry, and quite different from the old pro-China's leftist union. Obviously, they engage more actively in unionization of white-collar workers, civil servant, and public service sector. Labor activists were active organizing workers for industrial action, also actively engaged in labor legislation. These labor activists also led cross-sectoral mobilization to exert collective pressure on the government. It then helped to formulate the political culture, new political culture of civil society in Hong Kong on these issue-based alliances. It helped shape a new civil society, gathering resources to form local oppositional forces. Another major movement in that era is the housing movement. Housing movement emerged amidst the rapid development of the new town and the Met Ho's 10-year public housing program. the grassroots it was the main form of grassroots level engagement for all the religious group, voluntary agency, and student body. Based on community development at the neighborhood level, and it also served as a training ground for democratic politicians of the next generation. But another very significant development in Hong Kong over then is the growth and politicization of middle class. There was a rapid expansion of the state sector, service sector under neoliberal reform. Economic growth also proved the expansion of the middle class. According to Alvin's study, he sees the split within the middle class. On the one hand, you have a service professional, that means the social worker, teacher, where they were more enthusiastic in social reform, versus those corporate professionals, they are more conservative. The politicization of the middle class joined hand in hand with the activists engaging the grassroots movement. It faced a new challenge in the 1980s because the 1980s was the time when Sino-British negotiation over Hong Kong future started. Within the what is stipulated in the Sino-British Joint Declaration concerning the future of Hong Kong, it promised Hong Kong to develop democracy gradually. To accompany this development, the British Hong Kong government also introduced partial election in the new local administration scheme, and the consequences of that upon the development of radicalism and social movement is that social movement start to be institutionalized. Radicalism actions somehow are contained because the active, for very reason that the housing activists were absorbed by the district board election. Although the power held by the district board is very, very limited. They were only the consultative body, not holding any legislative power. Yet the pace and form of democratization is tightly controlled. What been promised in the basic law, later finalized in the 1980s, is only a half democracy. The pace and form of democratization was tightly controlled by Britain and as well as China. Both governments continue to make reservation of corporate interest and privilege as a top priority. And after the handover, we could witness the rapid growth of this new political formation as a corporate state. The late colonial rule was transformed itself into an what in Hong Kong they call the executive led bureaucratic bourgeoisie state. The basic law affirmed the role of functional constituency, very complex election system, as a bulwark against the pressure of popular democracy defined by universal suffrage. Class polarization increasingly worsened despite long-term economic boom. After the Nova, we could also witness the large-scale new liberalization of social service. You know, in Hong Kong, we actually had always been a limited government. So not much social services carried by the state, but still, like the public housing, the government tried to privatize this public housing. You know, a lot of these cases of collusion between government and business, and also in comparison with the British colonial government, the new regime also tried to have a more interventionist approach toward co-opting both the old community organization and the new community organization. Through the process of delegation of services to the poor government, community organization that would in turn favor the pro-establishment forces. However, in face of this huge change and change of political landscape and the balance of power, the oppositional political party indulged in what I call the virtual liberalism. That means they still stick to the rules of representative democracy as it is real or well-founded. that was the reason why many radicals feel alienated from the political party. Supposedly they are leading the pro-democracy movement, but you see they fail to satisfy what the activists want to push more actively forward their reform agenda. We have in Hong Kong then, after the 80s and especially after the handover, a very weak political democratic pro-democracy party. Since the basic law is post tight restriction over the pace of development of democracy, pro-democracy movement remain among all different kinds of social movement as a key political movement. The leaders of the Democratic Party could be identified as they have only very weak organization. They are in most cases, they are personality-based, too fragmented. They rely too much on the conventional media, put up media show, and this at the expense of doing real grassroots organization activities. They are also being accused as too elitist. In Hong Kong, within all these different pro-democracy parties, not a single party is based on mass membership. The leading party, like the Democratic Party, the party with the pigeon, sign, only have 300 members. The excuses for this weak development of the Democratic Party can be attributed to Hong Kong people are politically passive, the participation rate in party activity is low, and also for the very objective reason is that because there are only a very limited future for political career, the chance to have development in political field is very, very limited. Unless you want to join the pro-establishment party. They have a huge sum of money to support their activity, their community work, but the liberal, democratic party don't have this kind of resources to do so. And then vis-a-vis the political part, weak political party, we have very fragmented civil society. NGO, I define this civil society as mostly composed of the NGO. NGO constitute the political active civil society. Civil society bound to be pluralistic, no doubt about that. However, they can, in liberal democracy, this pluralistic social group can channel their demands through a fair democratic system. But in Hong Kong, they were constantly frustrated by the weak political party. They're too timid and too conservative in a sense. And civil society is not in a position to lead the political democracy movement. Whereas a political party relying on elections seldom use radical measures, not to confront the government or concerned official, not to alienate the moderate supporter. These moderate supporters usually were described as alleged to be the majority. The NGO activists were then usually frustrated by the politician and fed up with their style. The radical NGO or unorganized radical increasingly find they do not just want to criticize the government, but also the political party. So it caused a split within the pro-democracy movement. The alliance, the solidarity we saw during the Hanover period gradually collapsed. However, by and large, unity is still maintained as they usually come out to support pro-democracy movement in social protests or demonstration. Within Hong Kong, I'd like to pause for a little moment that given that we have a regime backed up by the CCP in Hong Kong, they have their delegate and they traditionally they belong to the labor unionists, and they also call themselves the leftists. Now we have a newly emerging civil society in Hong Kong. We have new kind of independent labor unionists, these civil society activists. They also support the idea of pushing more radical social reform into the agenda and want to implement all those values they cherish. In under this situation, what is the left? Echoing Professor Merrifield's talk in the early morning. In Hong Kong situation, we really face confusion that it is very difficult to differentiate the pro-China leftists now have actually been the one of the pro-establishment faction. Actually, they call themselves the establishment faction, right? Vis-a-vis the Democrat or pan-Democrat faction or the opposition. A new activism developed during the 70 and 80 new activists found it very difficult to locate itself. Most of these civil society activists were critical of the established pro-China left. They were influenced by the wide range of ideology, their orientation more pragmatic rather than ideological. More radical ones preferred to call themselves themselves the left wing, but not the leftist. I consider this still very confusing in English. The activists having the NGO affiliation or not often consider themselves as on the left, on the radical side. The political party on the liberal, the moderate, or even conservative side. Hong Kong faced a new watershed in 2003, 6 years after the handover. The counter Article 23, banning the National Security Bill campaign, draw out massive half a million show up demonstrator. It might be a decisive moment for the civil conscience awakening. Hong Kong, after this huge march, suddenly considered themselves as not as powerless they considered themselves, burdened with all the old political apathy representing the refugee society. Because refugee always consider it better to take Hong Kong as a shelter. It's only the haven, the refuge, not to disturb the rock boat here. You know, the establishment, the colonial government, actually absorbed this into their own governing ideology. And Hong Kong people also, for the older generation, also consider themselves as, well, we have to be politically apathetic. Don't bother about politics. But after this 2003 march, a lot of young people came out and considered themselves just like 50 years ago. The first baby boomer considered themselves, we should be in charge of the destiny of this city. So this march inspired a lot of young activists to engage in politics. Most of them chose not to join the political party because they were too conservative, they lost their leadership position, because they even, those party couldn't even foresee the huge show up of the people. And lost as a result the chance of asking, pressing for more concrete promises from the government for democratic reform. So they tried to join other group with the help of the internet. They joined self-organized ad hoc group. Also, in the year 2005, the anti-W protest in Hong Kong inspired a lot of young activists to use unconventional methods to protest. Very significantly, in the in terms of political ideology or in terms of how people think about politics, this focusing on adopting new way or new method to do protest action occupy most young staff's mind, rather than having whether you have a consistent ideology or not. The only thing that matters is whether you have an innovative method to show the power you should have. And then you can see a crisis embedded in this very big moment. It's the cleavage between the radical activists and the moderate party politicians. And you can see from this picture the huge show up of people in the 2000 and three marches. But another very significant moment, I'm very sorry that we don't have our legislative counsel, Lan Guohong, here, because I plan to assign him to answer all the spirit. The establishment of a League of Social Democrats, a very small a radical party. 2004 veteran radical former Trotskyist Lan Guohong was elected into the Legislative Council, and in 2006, a League of Social Democrats, Zemen Lim, was established. It marked the beginning of left-wing populism. That is a label that I think caused a lot of debate and discussion. RSC became the banner of new radicalism after 1997 and over. Performative protest action were brought into the governmental body. The use of these performative protest action within the Legislative Council is, according to the radical, is to ridicule and extol the absurdity of the undemocratic nature of the institution and also to dramatize the conflict and confrontation between the power and the people. Heresy claimed to be the radical Democrat. Now you have two brands of Democrat in Hong Kong, moderate versus the radical. They pose new challenges both to the government as well to the moderate Democrat. LRC put together all this intent about the establishment and the lack of progress of political democracy movement. We see several instances of these theatrical protest action within the chamber of the Legislative Council. Interestingly, you could see, although he cannot come today, Liang Guohong, on this picture. And another, you see the guy held his hand is another, nowadays being the most belonging to the most right-wing kind of populist. So you see initially, LSC as a composition having all these people who want to opt for more radical action within the chamber. You know, the chamber is no use. Well, what else can we do? We can do protests. And all these people motivated by this radical idea of doing something in the chamber, regardless of whether you have a more coherent political background or like Liang Guohong, the Trotskyites, they join hand in hand. But it's thought to be a kind of uneasy alliance because after a few years they break up, and you know, after a series of these break up of political factions. But on the other hand, apart from these the activists more inclined to do something within the mainstream polity, you see a new phenomenon. New phenomenon emerged is what I described as coming out of the new urban crisis. Deindustrialization and financialization of Hong Kong economy create new urban crisis, including the mega project, theme park, privatization of the public housing, and also the massive urban renewal project, destruction of destruction of social network. Both in Hong Kong, how do we deal with this new problem, new urban crisis, this problem? We find that both the NGO, they're basically single issue right-based advocacy, as was their main concern, and the Democratic Party did not know how to handle this issue. They had no vision other than dominating developmentalism ideology. They have no contesting social imagination or a better city life, apart from the old housing movement goal. That means, let us help the neighborhood, the resident to gain better compensation. Against this background, new urban activists, a group of new urban activists emerged. Also in the year 2006, spontaneous action to stop the demolition of first the Star Ferry Pier, followed by the campaign to preserve the Queen's Pier, the formation of Local Action, a new campaign group called Local Action, and Yi Dan-chong, one of the founding members, also with us today. They engage in various urban renewal projects, such as the Li Tong Street issue, and accumulate all this energy of engaging in this new urban activism accumulate in 2008 to 10, the anti-express rail lane movement. This campaign all ran beyond the old paradigm of Hong Kong oppositional politics. They were not for political right, not for redistribution justice. They no longer launched their campaign like the old NGO on rights-based advocacy. And heritage campaign, the Star Ferry and the Queen's Pier, draw a lot of young people joining, also the fringe member of the mainstream political party and also some NGO workers. They use a very novel way to do this demonstration or protest. They link up all these diverse activist group. Initially, they focusing on some of the isolated issues like the green issue, like the agricultural development issue, so on and so forth. This new urban activism create a stir in Hong Kong, stagnant political atmosphere at that time. Have 10,000 people surrounding the old Legislative Council to protest, and later it turned into a kind of a short term, within a day, a kind of occupation of the Central. So the occupying Central, most of you would know from recent news about Hong Kong, refer only to what happened 2 years ago. But actually, in 2010, we already had a very small scale, because people at that moment wouldn't imagine that they could occupy the street for protest purposes. After this occupation, a lot of this new urban activism, according to YC Chen and Mirana Sito, they characterize that as new preservation movement. The new preservation movement concern is to preserve historical significant cultural heritage, open up accessible public space, democratization of town planning. They also try to do something culturally. They try to inscribe unofficial history of the colonial architecture like the Queen's Pier. They reflect upon the new liberal developmentalist model of Hong Kong. They try to preserve existing way of life, community, socio-economic network, also quality of public service and new public values. The NPM, accompanied by the comprehensive utopian vision and program of the city, and also new vision and program of the social movement. I consider these NPM is also a kind of new cultural movement. It focuses on lifestyle, it focuses on cultural identity, it's more materialistic value basis. All the potential cultural resources, like people's nostalgia about the good old day and the collective memory of a particular architecture, then become a source of campaign mobilization. It could also be characterized as a kind of new radical reformism, a new kind of politics, because it supports cross-class alliances, it advocates democratization of town planning, it would invite not only the participation of the resident and the neighborhood level, but also join hand-in-hand with the professional, the art activists, and draw a lot of media attention. You see a vibrant new line of doing these urban movement emerge within those few years. And the activists call or characterize themselves as doing a kind of progressive localism. A new sense of Hong Kong historical power. The acceptance that accused, the acceptance I, of course, being welcomed, because it also, you always stand in opposition to what they want to do through this mega project, infrastructural project. They accuse the NPM as imbued with colonial nostalgia. Why do you protect the Queen's Pier? Because it reminds people only of the colonial past. You have to look forward. But the activists saw themselves going against the hegemonic colonial national discourses. They want to reinterpret the significance, historical significance of architecture, old architecture like Queen's Pier. Queen's Pier is not just the point, the place where Queen come to visit Hong Kong, but also a public space open for all the migrant worker, all the protester. You had a long history of collective memory inscribed in this building. They try to redefine what cultural identity means for them. So they give new meaning to identity, trying to argue that by doing this, by engaging this activism, they would create spaces for re-identification of locality. So locality for them is not a inward-looking kind of hanging on our old past, but an opportunity open up for every one of us to reinterpret history, to let the voices that have been silenced now have the chance to voice out in order to go beyond the national colonial binary. Right? So it is considered a kind of a new way to gain a renewed sense of what Hong Kong identity is about. So according to those who try to touch this kind of new potential to this NPM, they will consider is the identity issue for them is not just root searching, but also forward looking. It will also facilitate the decolonization of political culture because the handover for most of the Hong Kong people is just to, like Professor Lui Da Lok has once described, the mood before handover is everybody is fear about the future. So let's keep colonialism frozen. So keep all of everything untouched. So that we can have a smooth transition. But now you face the old colonial structure, the whole colonial power structure is dominating us and get things even worse. So we need to have decolonization, not in the sense of kicking out the Britain, because the British has already gone. They want to decolonize the whole political culture, the injustice built in the bureaucratic culture. They try to take decolonization in this sense. But all these talk about building new Hong Kong identity, this tempering with the mobilizing potential of the local identity, very quickly after the 2010 turned into a new kind, localism, what we would call, or fairly described as a xenophobic nativism. After the Express Rail Lane campaign, right-wing xenophobic localism emerged. People accept we should use the term nativism here. The motto for this nativism's call is Hong Kong people first. In 2011, 12, and 13, you could see a series of this campaign. Anti-birth tourism, anti-mainland tourist action, anti-new immigration, immigrants' welfare rights. All these series actually mark the increasing importance of this new nativist populism. You can see here more than 1,000 people getting up in front of this brand store, DNG in Hong Kong, protesting against a alleged forbidding Hong Kong people to take pictures in front of the shop. Only mainlander and foreigner were allowed to do so. The queue had a lot of shame and humiliation. Some people take action and say, we don't want to wait for the NGO to lead us to protest. We don't need the political party. They've been all in showing their subservient attitude toward the mainlander. They dare not to do so. Let me go there and protest, do a protest. And after that, a lot of people find that, well, actually you can do away with all these NGO activists, OMGO activists, and do away with all these party leaders, do our own action. Very spontaneous kind of protest. Later, this nativist mood transformed into a new power of cultural creativity, like this small group called Hong Kong Native Power. They invent this notion of the world locus, write up a song and demonstrating all these hatred or anger. And they post up these anti-locus advertisements. And you can see now a lot of these parallel examples from elsewhere, but let's see what happened in Hong Kong over those years. Mainlander is considered as the all the source of the problem, and then as kicked out of them, and they've been treated as locusts. Okay? this protest action even goes within the shopping mall, ridiculing the gesture or the all these things related, you can associate that with the mainlander. And they've been able to launch this action globally. The significance of this right turn of nativism, localism, I will try to analyze by saying that we define what radicalism means in Hong Kong. The surge of xenophobic localism was the accumulation of right-wing terms of populism, seeing the split between the radical and moderate Democrat over the issue of a political reform package of the general election in 2012. There was a mishandling of the issue resulting in collapse of the leadership and authority of the Democratic Party, and then increasingly, Hong Kong people, some Hong Kong people, will find that, well, we can do away with all these leaders, party leadership. And of course, all these actions has to be understood against the background of the whole Beijing opposed to what Hong Kong, from more moderate line to more hard line, from keeping Hong Kong relative autonomy, sticking to the promises of allowing Hong Kong to have high autonomy to a more interventionist approach, from keeping Hong Kong economic diversity to hasten integration with China, and also from the reliance of China on Hong Kong's strategic advantages to Hong Kong being bypassed the mainland cities. So the one instance where the Democratic Party's leadership or authority was dashed because they went to shake hands with the Chinese government represented in Hong Kong and to widely consider as a selling out of the original commitment toward pressing for more genuine kind of democratic reform, but they can't honor the promises. So a lot of people coming out to criticize the Democratic Party. And these criticisms against the mainstream oppositional forces gained wider and wider. What they achieved is, like all right-wing populists have been, you can find all over the world, is to recode the political space. A new sense of cultural crisis that then led to the new sense of urgency which facilitated the recoding of the political space. Or the liberal, left-wing, moderate, reformist section are all equally conservative and submissive to the status quo. They are one single political class, the elite class, in collusion to maintain the political stability. So not only the traditional pro-establishment party like Liberal Party, the DAP, they were conventionally considered as the pro-government side, the pro-establishment faction. But now, under this recoding of political space, Democratic Party are also the force for preserving political stability. Even the NGO, even the leftists, would consider as belonging to the establishment side. The mainstream Democratic Party were then increasingly being accused or criticized of for their so-called Greater China complex. They consider, when China gained democracy, Hong Kong can have the democracy. So China reform would be of a higher priority within this mainstream Democratic Party who been burdened by this so-called Greater China complex. This mainstream Democratic Party, because they're always supporting this so-called old idea of the reunion in democracy with China. That means they had failed in achieving democratic reform under the one country, two system arrangement. But all people can accuse that it has no ground. Historical evidence will show you fail, but you still stick to this line, and you're bound to fail. Also, they've been accused. Why they still stick to this? Because they are the middle class. Why they always treasure cosmopolitanism? Because and cosmopolitanism now in the eye of these nativists. Is equal to a non-commitment to local suffering. They can all the time buy a ticket, use a foreign passport, go somewhere else. That is why they will not commit in very local suffering. So the localism is defined as going against all these group of elite. They have been taking this leadership role of pro-democracy movement for too long. Why not we praise them? Those people are also accused of having blind faith in rational communication and still consider it possible to negotiate with CCP. Later on, these criticism against mainstream party spread to the NGO. They were attacked for their immigrant bias, but they defend immigrant privileges in terms of universal values. NGO activists were attacked as careerists. Doctrine of peaceful and non-violent struggle. The intention is, well, just to dismiss the crowd before it can upscale their action to a higher level. So in every occasion, you see the accusation of their leader, the activist leader, as selling out the crowd. This crowd is gathering. Why don't you upscale to occupy? Why don't you think something more violent and more effective? And they ridicule campaign and protest action as merely failed confederacy performance, occasion for photo taking, song singing, so on and so forth. Left-wing intellectuals were also attacked for their insistence on universal value, rational policy design, for their postmodernism, multiculturalism, internationalism. They are out of touch with reality. They always dream up possibility of having rational dialogue with the regime. They're being part of the establishment. They have no courage to confront the institution, but pretending to be progressive. One of the most important impact in terms of rhetoric or in terms of the idea about radicalism is they hold up this criteria of militant action. In Cantonese, it's called 勇谋, militant action. Because the nonviolent actions are rapidly repeatedly ridiculed and even rhetoric of revolution or violence loosely used by these nativists. Every campaign is viewed as occasional protest action. And political blaming, scapegoating, the characteristic every occasion of action, and then turned into that of blaming the nonviolent campaigner for their timidity or even their selling out the mask. So the kind of gesture of militant action actually is not really serious talking about how to do violent thing like the pro-China leftists done in 50 years ago in the 67 riot, but a kind of, according to the analysis of this right-wing populism, as a kind of a calculated break of supposed taboo. The taboo of a one-country system, no one dare to say you will go against that. But you see, recently, some people say, you won't be, because I dare to speak out. This one-country system didn't work. We won. What we want? What we want is sovereign dependency. Also, the taboo of political correctness, you always say we have to protect the human rights for the immigrant. Why? Why? And also the taboo of nonviolent resistance. Like right-wing populists of other places, they defend common sense against indeed political correctness in this highly intellectualistic fashion. They have a sort of theory backup. And then you see, roughly, we can have three wings. First is the city-state theory of ranching, one of my colleagues in Lingnan University, former. He had a set of comprehensive outline of what this right-wing populist politics is about. He claimed to have combined the left and the right agenda to justify the populist strategy, arguing that only if the populist sentiment allowed to unleash, that it can be guided and corrected. So he admittedly saying that, well, we are using populist as strategy. You guys didn't dare to do this strategy. Let's use this strategy. Other than that, you cannot do anything positive to contribute to anything new for Hong Kong. Why all the other populists? It created fear of the other, not only CCP, mainlander, pan-democrat, and left-wing, and so they called it left-hand, jiao-gao. It denounced PRC as having ruined all good Chinese culture, Hong Kong's rather place, genuine Chinese ancient culture is preserved, let us hang on to that and go again to mainland. Hong Kong has to reject the integration in China, anti-immigrant action is right. Hong Kong should have their own military power to defend itself. Hong Kong should exploit the chance of the coming Chinese economic bust to declare its own statehood and to join a new confederation of Greater China. So we are not cutting off from ourselves from China, but we define what China means. China is not the China we see now, not PLC. China is a set of symbolic resources that we can hang on to give us moral high ground to criticize the existing regime. Apart from Wenqin's city-state theory, we have the moderate wing of localism. They dare not to say one country system is has already failed. But they uphold the principle of Hong Kong, Hong Kongers first. Let us do something about controlling immigration, about the quota issue. And the third wing, another wing, emerged in the late 2 years, turned to the fashion seeking for Hong Kong nationalism. They talk about whether Hong Kong should have its own nationalism, ask for Hong Kong independence. So we see lately two legislative councillors being disqualified, coming out of this stream. They've been in high tension with the older guy, like Wenqin, or other people who hold more moderate attitudes. So we have basically three different ways to interpret or to develop these nativist ideas. It's Wenqin. There's a kind of meeting action, and he demonstrate himself. This one, he took this photo during the unbearable occupation in Mong Kok. He demonstrated how militant action mean here. We are not hurting others, but also a kind of a very spiritual kind of thing. Right? So he become a very mystic figure. People make fun of him. And okay, this another branch, calling for Hong Kong nation, destiny, self-determination. Say no to Chinese colonialism. This is a cover of the Hong Kong U publication. So it's written by a Hong Kong U student. Those protests, another very small bunch is asking for returning to the UK. Let's ask Chris Patton to take Hong Kong back so that we can revoke the Joint Declaration, and then, well, we could have another chance to asking for what we want, right? So they have different banner. It's the early Hong Kong autonomy movement banner, and these are more independent kind of asking for Hong Kong independence, the old British Hong Kong flag. But apart from this, I call right wing nativism. As a kind of populism, a kind of right-wing populism in Hong Kong. Actually, in Hong Kong, we see another type of populism, the pro-acceptance populism. The pro-acceptance can also adopt populist strategy and disruptive performance, keep action to stage a struggle against opposition can. In the name of the silent majority, pan-democrats are attacked. In the early stage, pro-acceptance group also launched their own anti-virtualism protest. They, like Liberal Party and DAB, constantly use refugee issue to attack the Democrat Party. They also use disruptive tactics to challenge like civic party engagement in social rights issues, attacking their liberal stand. And the populist rhetoric also used to criticize the judge and the court judgment. They employ also a lot of this transgressive act of populist on the opposition camp, appropriate by the evidence to blame the whole pandemic. You see these people who don't follow our great central government say, you see, you belong to the same group. No, you are protecting them. Right? When they do something out of line, you come out to defend them. You be their lawyer and then defend them. A lot of conspiracy, a lot of Apollonian attack too. So you see a sample of their action. Jump on the table, like in this occasion, usually you will have one or two or several, a dozen pro-establishment populists coming in and accusing you of what you're talking about, criticizing the government. Don't be the dog of the British. right, we should be people who both love Hong Kong and love China. And this anti-immigrant protest by this Liberal Party too, pro-establishment party. So what I'm asking, what I'm thinking of, is how do we consider their relationship? This pro-establishment populists uphold patriotic Chinese identity, they are antagonistic to Hong Kong localists in terms of political identity issue, yet they are in some sense mirror image of each other. It allows the right-wing populists on the oppositional side to further justify their side reaction. It's a, well, it's just a reprisal, a tit-for-tat rebuttal. Nothing wrong about us. It also allows them to deny their being on the far right, because the experience that those who are seven public are the real fascists. Who is a fascist? You accuse me of doing this anti-mainland action as fascist or working on being a fascist? Come on, let's see. The real fascists are behind us. Okay? So, to further problematize the action, it's not just a question of what the left is, but also what is the true right wing. Who is the true far right in Hong Kong situation? In any case, the liberal are under fire. Both attack from the Democrat for their liberal values, elitist status, not representing the true interests of the common people. So vigor, radicalism. Now at the rhetorical level, I may say that the right-wing localist has appropriated the language of radicalism. When you are talking about doing radically, doing something radically, or having a radical mind about genuine changing Hong Kong's dire situation, all these languages have been appropriated by the right wing. They already reject what constitutes the larger part of emotional and effective appeal. From the literature spent on studying the growing phenomenon of the right-wing populism, especially in Europe, what I find is a lot of discussion about how to evaluate populism. Of course, the mainstream social scientists, what I thought is most hold a negative view, of course, because this right-wing populism always carry this authoritarian and reaction element. They are always liberal, they are commonly exclusive ethno-nationalism. But there are also some people who consider populism as inevitable corrective to the alienating, ossified democratic government institution. According to this idea, this perspective, populism is an occasional observer of faith as a means of renewal. Like Margaret Kenwan, she considered populism as a perceptive critique of the democratic limitation within liberal democracy. There are always, according to her, there is always a gap between performance and promise of liberal democracy. She said, populism is democracy shadow. It's a redemptive moment of democracy. Also, we also have another figure like Laclau, who see populism as a chance or opportunity to repoliticize democracy, where the left and right converge into apolitism. Political terms will be fair for management. According to Laclau, people is always a construct. Either you could construct in the left-wing approach or the right-wing approach. Frustrated members of demos do not feel being represented. There are always the hotbed for the growth of populism. Mofei also consider the way out of this predicament of populism is to divide opposition between left and right to show people that we have real alternative. I do not have a definite view about all these debates and arguments, but I would like to make several observations to end my dissertation today. Firstly, is as Hong Kong is never a fully full democracy, therefore any disaffection of discontent that the populace exploit are not just alienating aspects of democratic procedure or institution, but a reaction to the utter lack of democratic accountability. Second, also precisely because Hong Kong system is inherently undemocratic, any real democracy movement that can call people to participate would unavoidably look populist, because those actions would have to transcend the capacity of the existing undemocratic institution for popular will to be expressed. The third point is, those who degrade the discontent as expression of deplorable populism always also carry with them the assumption that we are living in a real liberal democracy, but indeed we are not. And that is the common era of what I call the virtual liberalism. The fourth point I want to make is, however, the populist politics, which is exclusionary, cannot really empower the people to renew their passion and faith in democracy. They would only reaffirm their powerlessness and cynicism. And fifthly, only by substantiating the concept and practices of participatory democracy, they can empower people who are both by existing limited institutional means and by non or extra institutional engagement and activism, that we can redeem our faith in democracy and social reform. So, strategic review upon all these participatory channels, including election to the public body and different field and battlefront of civil society, is called upon. That's a way to revive radicalism and the spirit of this city. Thank you.